गुड मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट्स, येस्टरडे वी हैव डिस्कस्ड रिएक्टिविटी सीरीज एंड केमिकल प्रॉपर्टीज ऑफ नॉन मेटल्स. टुडे वी विल डिस्कस हाउ डू मेटल्स एंड नॉन मेटल्स रिएक्ट. एज यू नो, ड्यूरिंग द डिस्कशन ऑफ केमिकल प्रॉपर्टीज ऑफ मेटल्स, वी ऑब्जर्व that metals react with a number of reagent and form different compounds. But why do metals react in this manner, or why do metal and non-metals react and form, how do metals and non-metals react and form compounds? As we have discussed in class 9th about the electronic configuration of elements, and learnt that noble gases have completely filled valence shells and they show very little reactivity or very little chemical activity. Beside that, before the discussion of chemical properties of metals and non-metals, we have discussed then that metals and non-metals donate or accept electrons to attain nearest noble gas configuration. Metals, as we know, donate electrons, and non-metals accept electrons to attain nearest noble gas configuration, and that they do so to make them stable. For example, noble gases like helium, as we have seen, helium, it has atomic number 2, so it has 2 electrons in outermost orbit. Beside that, if we discuss about other noble gases that are neon, then argon, krypton, xenon and radon. As helium has atomic number 2, neon have atomic number 10, so it has electronic configuration like that 2-8. And argon, it has atomic number 18. It has electronic configuration like that 2-8 and 8. So helium, as we know that it is chemically inert, and it has only one orbit or one shell, and in that it has 2 electrons. So according to the formula 2n² we know, if 2n square is there, mean orbit number is 1, 2 into 1 into 2 electrons. Mean in, if the atom has one orbit or one shell, and if it has one shell, so first orbit can have only 2 electrons, and if it has 2 orbits, these are called as KLM shells, and if it has 2 orbits, then it can have 2 and 8 electrons. As in case of neon, 2 and 8 K shell have 2 electrons. So first orbit can have only 2 electrons, 2 electrons are there. L orbit can have 8 electrons, and it has 8 electrons. So the noble gases that show that they are stable or they are chemically inert, they have their completely filled outermost orbit. But if we take the example of compound sodium chloride NaCl, mean formation of compound NaCl. NaCl, this is sodium chloride, if we see that this is the metal and this is non-metal. Metal Na, it has atomic number 11, so its electronic configuration will be like that, 2 8 and 1. Then chlorine, it has atomic number 17 and it will have electronic configuration like 2 8 and 7. So if we see in case of sodium, outermost orbit, this is KLM shell, outermost orbit have one electron and it can easily donate or lose this electron from M shell to become stable. But now if it lost this electron, one electron, it has two shells, completely filled two shells, but it has 10 electrons in K and L shell, 10 electrons, but its nucleus has 11 protons. And in case of chlorine, as we are saying here, it has 7 electrons in outermost orbit. 7 electron mean it will it want to take one more electron to complete its outermost orbit or become stable. So it will gain one electron and it will become 8. Then its nucleus will have 18 electrons and 17 protons. When in this case, in the case of chlorine, it will have 18 electrons and 17 protons. So if we see in the both cases, in case of sodium, its outermost orbit have one electron, it can easily lose its one electron from M shell. This is M shell, it can easily donate that. But now its nucleus has 11 proton, but the number of electron is 10. So there is a net positive charge giving us a sodium ion. It will become like that, Na positive, by giving or donating one electron. In case of chlorine, as we see that it has 7 electrons in outermost orbit and it requires one more electron to complete its octet. If and in case if sodium and chlorine have to react, the electron lost by sodium, when it has lost the electron lost by Na could be taken up by chlorine. And after gaining one electron, the chlorine atom get a unit negative charge because its nucleus has now 18 electrons and 17 protons. This gives us a chlorine negative. So both these elements can give and take relation between them. And it will be like that, Na positive, Cl negative. In case of Na, it will give one electron and form positive charge. Cl, it will gain one electron plus electron and it will form like that, Cl negative. And they have the configuration like that, Na, Cl, it will be given by it and it will form like that, Na positive and Cl negative. So this is the way by which metals and non-metals combine and form the compound form. So we see in this case, Na positive and chloride negative ions being oppositely charged attract each other and are held by a strong electrostatic force of attraction to exist as sodium chloride. Mean if they have to exist like that, they will form or join by strong electrostatic force of attraction, and the compound formed by the transfer of electrons from a metal to non-metal are known as ionic compounds. So this is the definition of ionic compounds: the compounds formed by transfer of elements from a metal to a non-metal is ionic compound or electrovalent. It is also called as electrovalent compound, and the bond between them is called as ionic bond. In this positively charged ion is called as cations, and negatively charged ion Cl, it is called as anion. Now about the properties of this ionic compounds, for this an activity is given on page number 48, that is activity 3.13. in this activity it is given, if we take samples of some compounds or salts like sodium chloride, barium chloride, then potassium iodide, etc., or any other salt, and wants to check their physical state, then we observe that they are mostly solid and hard. And if we heat them directly on the flame, we observe that they do not melt but burn, showing different colors flame. And in case we dissolve them in water or kerosene or petrol, then we observe they dissolve in water, or but they are they do not dissolve in kerosene or petrol. Beside that, if we want to check that if they are conducting electricity or not, mean if they are dissolved in water after dissolving them in water, if they are conducting electricity or not, then we observe that they conduct electricity only when they are dissolved in water. So on the basis of this activity, we can give general properties of ionic compounds that are also given on page number 49, and points or properties are like that: physical nature, they are generally solid and hard but can be brittle. They are solid and hard due to strong force of attraction. As we know that solids particles are tightly packed, then they have high melting point and boiling point, as large amount of heat energy is required to break the strong ionic forces of attraction. Mean the that ionic bond that is in between them can be broken by heating them or by melting them at high point. They are soluble in water and insoluble in kerosene or petrol, as we have seen in the activity. Then in solid state, they do not conduct electricity, but in molten form they can conduct electricity. In solid form they cannot conduct electricity, as ions cannot move due to rigid solid state, but conduct electricity in molten state, as ions can move freely since the electrostatic force of attraction between the oppositely charged ions overcome due to heat. Means the heat energy breaks the inter ion electrostatic forces of attraction and they conduct electricity. This chapter we have to do up to page number 49, up to the questions, and occurrence of metals are deleted for this year's syllabus. So we have finished our this chapter, metals and non-metals. That's all for today.